You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we're going to open the phones and hear from the listening audience. We've had a week and last night of you listening to me. Now tonight everybody gets to listen to you. So it's going to be open topic, open phone, open subject, open everything. I wasn't sure that we'd have a broadcast tonight because all afternoon we've been having some pretty good rain and lots of lightning. And with lightning, I have to shut down the station. Can't broadcast. But the skies are not clear now, but there's no lightning and there's no thunder, and the rain has moved off to the east. And so I decided to go ahead and do the broadcast live, but it was touch and go. So we're gonna open the phones and let you guys have your say tonight. Whatever it is that you've got on your mind, what's happening? What's going on in the world that you want to talk about? Because that's what we're going to talk about tonight. 520-333-4578 is the number. We're going to take your calls for the whole broadcast. And I'm trying to remember. Aha, there it is. 520-333-4578 is the number. Open topic, open phones. You're the stars tonight. Folks, I gave you the wrong number. The phone lines are still switched around, so the correct number to call is 520-333-4543. That's 520-333-4543. So use that number tonight. Write it down, 520-333-4543. Phones are open. Taking your calls for the whole broadcast. Isn't that great music, folks? Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. Cooper. This is Moondog here. You may recognize my voice from other places. I have a question that some of your listeners might be able to answer. I heard tonight that the FBI has placed what they call a keystroke logger on a gentleman's computer. The case has gone to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has really chastised the FBI and asked them how they do this without getting a federal wiretap authorization. The FBI refused to say how they do it because it's a matter of national security, so to speak. I know nothing about this. I don't even own a computer. And I'm just wondering if some of your listeners could possibly enlighten us on this.
I can tell you how. It's called tyranny. You go in and you scare people and you make them think that if they don't cooperate with you, they're going to get investigated, and just about anybody will do damn near anything for any Fed that comes along because they're too stupid to realize that it's unconstitutional. and that when they allow it to be done to somebody else, they've all, you know, when they take freedoms away from somebody else and protections away from someone else, they've also stripped themselves.
Well, the whole situation arose because the FBI suspected that this person was using advanced crypto technique for transmitting...
I know the case very well, and apparently you two do too. Why are you ducking around the fact that the guy they put this on was a mafia guy?
I am not... Hey, if they can do it to him, they can do it to us.
That's right, but what I want to know is why are you dancing around it? Why didn't you...
I didn't know he was a mafia guy. I know he had an Italian name.
Then how do you know so much about this case?
I just heard it on the radio about an hour ago.
Okay, well, he's a mafia guy. He's a member of the mafia. There's no doubt about that. They're investigating him. It doesn't make any difference. But, you know, I hate to have things slanted. If we're going to talk about something, I want the truth out in the open. So he's under investigation for criminal activity, and they think that he may have been using some code to communicate his criminal activity with. So they're, you know... They bugged his keyboard without a wiretap.
How do they do that? Have they got some sort of remote apparatus that can pick all this stuff up?
Just exactly like I told you. You see, if somebody has a meth lab, now I'm not condoning meth labs, but I'm using this as an example. If somebody has a meth lab here in this valley, okay, they're buying their chemicals here at the local drugstore or two cities away or something like that, and they're making methamphetamine right here, okay?
Gotcha.
And they're selling it right here. They're not selling it anywhere else. They're not going across state lines or anything else. Why do the local police, who know damn well the feds have no authority, give the DEA the authority to bust these people and arrest them and imprison them on federal charges when they have no jurisdiction whatsoever, has nothing to do with interstate or international commerce?
It must be simply a matter of their own ignorance.
It's called stupid police chief. It's called a police chief who's really working for the feds instead of the community, and whenever he does that, he's declaring himself incompetent. In other words, he's saying to his community, I don't have the competence or the knowledge or the skill to handle these drug problems. So instead of trying to figure out how to get that and keep our jurisdiction and not have these incursions by the federal government outside their jurisdiction, I'm going to call them in and let them handle it because that's the easy way out and it makes me look good.
That's lazy, too, besides being stupid.
It's also treasonous.
Yeah, I hear you.
To the state of Arizona. He's allowing an outside jurisdiction to impinge upon the sovereignty of this state.
Well, my real question is, how did the feds manage to get a hold of the keyboard signal without actually connecting physically with copper to the computer?
Well, that I don't know, but I bet you there's a 14-year-old kid out there who knows enough about computers that he could probably give us the answer in about 10 seconds flat.
Well, that's the guy I hope calls next or within the next hour.
Okay.
I've said my word. I'll get off and let somebody else get in.
Thanks. Thanks for calling. Good question. Real good question. How are they doing it? And why are they getting away from it? Yes. Gestapo. That's what they really are. 520-333-4543 is the number. Be taking your calls for the whole hour. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, how you doing, Bill?
Good.
Yeah, I got like a question. A topic about that I know that brings smoke that comes out of both your ears and stuff. But what that is the elimination of the income tax versus the flat tax. And I know that you say like with the income tax that it's unconstitutional and stuff. And I myself,
it's not only unconstitutional, but there's no law passed by Congress that requires me to file and pay it.
Right.
I've put out a challenge for years now. Not one person can produce such a law.
And my problem with that is that, what about the revenue to provide for a defense, you know, by the federal government?
That's not my problem. My problem is making sure that a Hitler doesn't take over this country and cause us to come under unconstitutional despotic rule. The Constitution gives the government the means to do what it needs to do within its own jurisdiction. including taxes, excises, levies, imposts, duties, all kinds of things. They could even conceivably go into business, and they've already done that, we know.
Right.
But are you trying to say that we should ignore the Constitution, we should throw our freedoms away so that we can have, what was it you said?
You know, provide for defense. As you know, the main role of the federal government is to provide for defense.
No, it's not.
Purposes,
that's not the main role of the federal government. It's not the main role at all.
Well, constitutional, isn't it? I mean, my point is that
the only standing military.
We're not living in 1890 anymore, and then we have countries like
so what?
North Korea.
So what?
And we China have, and Iraq.
So what? We have a law. It's called the Constitution.
I understand that. I understand your point completely. I'm not disagreeing.
It's not
with
a
you.
Point. It's the law. They have to stay within the law. If they're not within the law, then they're committing treason. They have become despots. They become tyrants. They are no longer our government when they do that. And I don't care how they justify it. And I don't care how many of you misinformed people who don't care about your Constitution or your rights or your protections under the law want to know how they're going to pay the military. It's not my concern. My concern is that they don't destroy the Constitution, take away our rights.
Yeah, are we, it's are a we, conundrum, you know what I mean? I agree with everything that you're saying. I don't want to.
It's not a conundrum. It is not a conundrum. It is not a conundrum. It is not. They are required by the law, the Constitution, to stay within the limits and the restrictions of the Constitution.
I agree.
If they can't do it, then they don't have a military or whatever it is they're trying to fund that they don't have enough money for. We have militaries in the states. We have the militia. We have the National Guard.
Yeah, but the problem is, look at Clinton. During the Clinton years, the Chinese actually used money to influence the election in 96 and stuff by buying up officials and so forth, you know?
Yeah. What's that?
The problem with that is that...
What's that got to do with income tax?
Well, the point being is that the Chinese are making the move with Hutchinson Wen Po with the Panama Canal. And
so,
moving into our hemisphere.
I'm going to ask you again, what's that got to do with the income tax?
For providing a defense. Who's in charge of the defense?
Yeah. Who's the commander in chief? Bullshit.
The president.
Okay. Now, who bought the president?
Well, the Red Chinese were trying to.
According to you, you said they did.
Well.
So I'm going to ask you again, what's that got to do with the income tax or the defense? Clinton wanted to sell us down the tubes to the Red Chinese while he was president. He did a pretty good job of it, and we couldn't have won a war with them during his presidency. And it has nothing to do with the income tax. It has to do with official corruption by the socialist, communist, puke fakes, lying traitors in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, but my
And no amount of income tax is going to overcome that.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to say, though, is that I don't support the income tax per se, but all I'm trying to say is that there's got to be some kind of revenue stream to provide for defense against that type, countries that are hostile to our interests.
You ever read the Constitution?
Yes, I have.
Then what does it say about how the government can raise money?
Well, it can be done through tariffs and, like you said, excises and imposts and stuff like that.
And lots of other things, too.
Yeah.
It says Congress can levy a tax. They can even levy a direct tax as long as it's apportioned according to the population of each state.
Right. That's true.
Well, what's that got to do with the income tax? They can levy a tax for as much money as they want. They can take everything out of your pocket that you ever had or ever will have if they want. But they have to do it under the law.
Right.
And the way they're getting away with it is stupid people like you who don't understand how the law works is willing to say, well, even though it's unconstitutional, it's bad, and even though I don't support it, we need the income tax because we must have a defense. You're stupid. Do you hear me? Thank you for calling. 520-333-4543. I don't cut you any slack, folks, when you're stupid. You see, you might want to give away your freedoms. And if you do, I suggest you go to Cuba. Castro will be happy to take your freedoms, provide you with a military, give you a machete, and designate a portion of the cane fields for you to cut, and you can be happy. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Cooper. This is Marie from Colorado.
Hi, Marie.
Hi. When you took your vacation at the end of June, the beginning of July, one of the rebroadcast programs that WBCQ ran was the program that you had where you asked people to call in and tell you who they were going to vote for and just a brief why. And sometimes you'd ask them, like someone who said he was voting for Howard Phillips or another person who said they were voting for Charles Collins or something like that.
Yeah.
You asked, do you really think he has a chance of getting in? And that person paused for a moment, and then he said, well, I think if enough of us vote for him, yes. And then at the end of the program, you told us to all look at Article 2, Section 1 in the Constitution.
Right.
And that everything is basically, your vote counts at the local and state level, but the Electoral College is the one that puts the president in.
That's exactly right.
And my husband and I were rather surprised at that. So we have this little booklet that has the Constitution, Bill of Rights, Declaration of Independence, and it came from Liberty Lobby, and we picked it up at a gun show.
Uh-huh.
And so we looked it up, and sure enough, I read it all out loud to my husband, and we were there like, wow, we actually, as citizens, should be more involved at the state level where everything really counts. With this Electoral College.
That's right.
And we were really surprised because you never hear anybody promoting that.
Well, you know why? Because very few people, until I started challenging people in this broadcast many years ago, mm-hmm. very few people in this country have ever seen a copy of the Constitution, much less read it. They don't even know what their country is. And the only place you can find it is in that document. That is where the United States of America dwells.
Mm-hmm.
Nowhere else.
Yes. That's true. So anyway, I have this little booklet of the Constitution out, and you are right when you said it's not very long, and it's written in plain English, and so it was on the kitchen table for a couple of days, so I picked it up and I read it, and I was very, very impressed. You're right, it's not long, and it is in plain English.
Yeah.
But what really impressed me, and I just have to tell you this, and folks, if you haven't picked up a Constitution yet, read it. You'll be very impressed. Article 1, you don't go too far into it, just Section 8, it's the duties of Congress.
Right.
And it's like, wow, is that all they're supposed to do?
That's all they're supposed to do.
And
look at all the other stuff they got their fingers into.
Yes.
Where they don't belong.
Exactly. There's nothing in there about they're not, you know, my goodness gracious, they're not supposed to blackmail the states into doing what they want them to do. There's nothing about being involved in education, in child care, and absolutely nothing in social services.
Actually, the Constitution forbids it. The Constitution says that not any of the states can make a treaty with any other state.
Yes.
When the state of Arizona makes an agreement with the federal government to get money from the federal government so that they can build highways, and there's strings attached that says if they do that, they have to teach our children certain subjects and use certain textbooks, that is what's called a treaty. An agreement between states is a treaty.
Uh-huh.
The state of Arizona is a sovereign state, and the United States of America is a sovereign state. It's forbidden. Yes. It is absolutely forbidden to do that.
And also, I'm not sure I'm reading this right, but on where it comes to Article 3, where it talks about the Supreme Court, in listening to the debates where Bush and Gore were debating, and the subject came up about the Constitution, so I really, after listening to you, I kind of pricked up my ears, even though I never read the Constitution since I was in high school. Gore had said he believed that the Constitution was a living document to be interpreted as we went along and as need rose, and since it was a living document, it could be changed because all living things change. And I thought that sounds kind of hokey. And then Bush came back with, well, this is where we disagree. I believe that a law is set in stone or something to that effect, he said, and that it should be applicable for all people at all times, and so that you know what it is said and that it cannot be changed to suit whatever situation you're in. And I just wanted your input on that.
No, it cannot be. This document cannot be changed at all or interpreted, nor the meaning changed by anyone whomsoever, except by the method so stated in this document for doing that. And what is it called? It's called an amendment.
Oh, okay.
And the document explains exactly how an amendment can be passed and adopted as a part of this Constitution. And if it's not done, then it is not a part of this Constitution. You can't change anything in this.
So that means that the Supreme Court can't be pulling out all of these straws that it pulls out, like somehow in here we're supposed to find where we have a constitutional right to have an abortion?
No. No.
I didn't think so. I didn't see anything in there because I thought, let me see if they see anything about having an abortion.
No, the Constitution divided the power amongst three branches of government.
Mm-hmm.
The executive, the judicial, and the legislative.
Mm-hmm.
The executive and the judicial cannot legislate. The legislative cannot perform executive tasks, nor give orders to the military forces, nor can they perform the judicial functions of government.
Mm-hmm.
But here's what the Supreme Court is doing. The Supreme Court, when it does that, is grabbing the power of the the legislative branch. They're legislating. You can't have an amendment to the Constitution except through certain means, and they all involve Congress.
Mm-hmm. Well, isn't the judicial branch of the state doing that when, like here in Colorado, we passed that by popular vote, not this past election, but the one before, about the homosexuals not giving them special minority status, you know, like handicapped people and that, and then
all people must be.
The judicial went and overturned it and says, well, that's not right.
Well,
and it's like, what? Where did the power of the people come in when we vote something and then it's overturned?
It has nothing to do with the power of the people or the power of the state Supreme Court. It has to be according to the law. And the law says all citizens must have equal status under the law. Therefore, you cannot grant special protection or special status to one group, minority or not. That's unconstitutional in every state and in the United States. That was a political decision, and your Supreme Court legislated against its own constitution to give special status to a group of people, making them and actually making you not equal under the law.
That's correct. Yes,
it elevates that group above all other citizens under the law. And that is wrong. That's despotism.
Yes.
And it only happens in democracies. And if you want to find out what kind of government we have and what kind of government we're guaranteed, read Article 4, Section 4.
Article 4, Section 4.
Yep.
Okay, that's about amendments.
Nope. Article 4. Section 4.
Oh,
I memorized.
Four. Oh,
I memorized the Constitution years ago. The United States shall guarantee to every state in this union a republican form of government, and shall protect each of them against invasion and on application of the legislature or of the executive when the legislature cannot be convened against domestic violence, period.
Mm-hmm.
So what is all this talk about a democracy?
I don't know.
Democracy is a form of despotism. It is tyranny of the majority over the minority.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and what people don't seem to understand, like here in the news, there, at least our local news here is talking about how they're going to try and keep up this wave of trying to change the Electoral College, so the president has voted in by a direct vote of the people. And what people don't seem to realize is the pressure that can be put on them and manipulated, like you read in all of these different foreign countries all over, you know, some of the people standing out there with machine guns knocking on your door, your place of business, saying, hey, you know, you better vote such and such a way. And here in the United States, you think that can't happen here?
Sure it can. But you don't. Sure. You wouldn't want it to happen anyway, because most people are ignorant and too stupid to vote for president. They don't even know what their country is. They don't know anything about the Constitution. They don't know when somebody's a good candidate or a bad candidate. They haven't got the slightest idea. They vote from emotionalism or because somebody looks nice on television or they like the way they sound or they're telling them they're going to give them something. They're not voting in the best interest of their state, their community, or of this country.
That is very true.
They vote out of ignorance and stupidity and selfishness, greed.
Oh, especially.
The founding fathers knew that. They wrote about it. They talked about it. That's why they gave us the Electoral College. And the electors were supposed to be chosen by the legislatures. But they worded it wrong. They said the method to be chosen shall be determined by the legislature of each state. When what they really intended or meant was that the legislature choose the electors in order to more properly represent the sovereignty of the state and the people who lived in that state.
Mm-hmm.
So the legislatures in most states have a popular election to determine who the electors are going to be. And all these years, the American people thought they were voting for president when they were voting for Joe Blow, the car dealer, who's going to go be an elector. And they don't know that Joe Blow doesn't have to vote the way they want him to, even though state law may require him to, because once he becomes an elector, he's no longer subject to state law, but to the dictates of the Constitution, which says he can vote any way he wants to.
Oh, that's fascinating.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it sounds like I should go and find out where I could get a copy of our state constitution to find out what it says.
That's right, because I'll tell you something that you don't understand and most Americans don't understand.
Uh-huh.
Your first loyalty is to God.
Right.
Your second loyalty is to your family.
Yes.
Your third loyalty is to your state. Your fourth loyalty is to the United States of America.
Then, you know, in our textbook, the Civil War is written up all wrong. It was originally called the War Between the States, and it had nothing to do with slavery. It had everything to do with states' rights and whether the states had the right to secede from the Union when they didn't agree with everything that was happening.
No, that's not true.
Then what is true?
States did have the right to secede from the Union, and they did, and nobody was stopping them, and everything was fine until a bunch of people who wanted to have a war with the Union fired upon Fort Sumter in Charleston Harbor.
So as long as there wouldn't have been a first shot,
If the South had never fired on the North, there would never have been a Civil War, period.
That's fascinating.
It sure is.
Yes, it is.
They're teaching junk in our schools, lies, crap. They teach blacks that the Civil War was fought over slavery. And the blacks look to Lincoln as their hero. Lincoln didn't want to free the slaves. In fact, he said that he was never going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Until the North got in big, big trouble. They were on the brink of actually losing the war. The Southern Army was on the doorstep of Washington, D.C.,
yes.
And the federal agencies were packing up, getting ready to flee to the North.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When Lincoln gave the Emancipation Proclamation in the hopes that the slaves would rise up against their Southern masters. But it didn't happen.
No.
Almost everybody in this country is laboring under lies, deceptions.
Mm-hmm.
They're ignorant. Yes. And because they're ignorant and because they don't care about the truth, that makes them stupid in my estimation.
Mm-hmm. And just one more thing and then I'll get off and let somebody else talk. But I also read in here in the Declaration of Independence,
uh-huh.
And it lists many, many, many reasons why the colonies felt they had a right and a duty to before God and their fellow citizens that they should go and be separated from Britain. And I'm reading some of this stuff, and I'm thinking, you know what? A lot of this is most of it actually is happening today.
And hundreds of times worse than it ever did when our founding fathers made that fateful decision.
So, anyway, I just wanted to say thank you.
To me. Most people have listened for years and they still don't have a copy of the Constitution. Still haven't read it. Still haven't got a clue. They're still ignorant. They're still stupid. And they're still sitting there with their thumb in their ear wondering, what happened to my country?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, well, you take care and God bless you.
Thank you for calling.
Okay. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Seek ye the truth and the truth will make you free. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello?
Yeah, hi.
Hello?
Okay. Can you hear me?
I've said hello twice.
Okay. I'm sorry.
What do you want me to say?
Well, my fan's ringing in my ear. The way they do it, Bill, is that, are you familiar with Tempest?
Now, what exactly are you talking about?
The FBI about? Getting in the guy's computer.
Okay.
Monitoring it.
Okay.
I'm
familiar with Tempest, but not everybody is.
Okay, all computers radiate. If they can get it within the close proximity of wherever the computer was, they just pick it up on the radio.
Well, they can see your screen that way.
Oh, yeah.
But they're talking about tapping the keyboard.
Well, they physically tapped it.
Physically, in some manner, tapped the keyboard.
Well, they wouldn't have to unless the guy had a screen.
That's not the point.
That's
what they're doing. They're physically tapping the keyboard.
Well, that's right. And it's against the law, regardless, unless they could prove the guy had done something wrong.
I think they're illegally entering the house and doing it. That's what I think.
Sure.
But I don't know that.
Well, there's another scam now with Internet providers, for example, like mine. They do it under a guise of providing email screening, but it's all routed through a place in California, which I'm sure is a shell operation for the FBI or CIA.
Well,
or one of those.
How do you know that? Because I hear this all the time, but it's, you know, depending on who you listen to, it's in Virginia, or it's in Montana, or it's a special hub down in Texas.
Oh, no, you run a trace route.
Pardon?
You run a trace route, and it'll show you where the guy's at.
Show you where what guy's at.
The screener is, okay?
All you can do with a trace route is find out where your email goes before it gets to where it's delivered.
Oh, no, but I can run a trace route and tell who the screener is.
All you can tell is what hubs it goes through.
Okay.
And it could be routed through all different kinds of hubs, and one day it might go through a route to where it's going, and another time it might go through the south.
Exactly.
So how do you know it's going to some hub and there's a screener there?
Because I ran the trace route on the provider that does the screening for my ISP, and he is located in, I believe, somewhere in
Southern. How do you know he does a screener for your ISP?
Pardon me?
How do you know he does screening for your ISP?
Because it was the guy announced it. Most people don't understand what's going on, but it was all emailed to me, and I'm sure other people too. It routes through this screener, and then it comes back to your ISP. And
how do you know it's a screener? You haven't answered my question yet.
Because that is the way it's advertised. They do it under the guise of, and they do filter junk mail.
How do you know that?
Because I get messages from them.
Messages from who saying what?
From the screener saying, we have quarantined such and such pieces of mail, blah, blah, blah. But the crux of the thing is that all of my mail goes through them.
They have absolutely no right to do that unless you agreed to it when you signed the contract with the ISP.
Well, the ISP put that in.
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't bother me.
Doesn't matter. They still do not have any right to do it whatsoever unless you sign a contract agreeing to allow them to do it.
Well,
and it should bother you. Should bother everybody.
Yeah, it bothers me. But what it boils down to is your choices are either go to a different ISP or just continue. I have nothing to hide.
I'm absolutely amazed at that. It's no different than somebody at the post office opening every letter that you send and every letter that you receive and reading it. Would that bother you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah! Wow, light just came on. Another stupid sheeple. Where are you people coming from? Thanks for calling. I bet that woke some people up. Oh, I don't care. Your email is mail. It's no different than writing it on a letter, putting it in, sticking a stamp on it, and sending it through the postal service. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Bill. I would like to say right off the bat, I'm an absolute outright sheeple.
Well, most people are, but you know what? You got a leg up on all the rest of them because you know it and they don't.
Well, here's my question. How do I go about getting a pocket pamphlet of the Constitution of the United States?
Well, are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Okay, you can write the Commission on the Bicentennial of the United States Constitution.
Okay.
808.
Uh-huh.
17th Street. Northwest.
Mm-hmm.
Washington, D.C.
Okay.
20006.
20006.
Yeah.
And would you give me the heading of that again, the very beginning?
Commission?
Yeah, Commission.
On the Bicentennial.
Bicentennial.
Of the United States Constitution.
Of the United States, okay.
There's also a number you can call, 202.
202.
USA.
USA.
Dash 1787.
Dash 1787.
Now,
okay.
if you can't get it there, you can get a copy of the Constitution from any United States government printing office.
Oh.
You can also find a copy of the Constitution at any library.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
You can also get a copy of the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and a whole bunch of other things from the Fully Informed Jury Association. I don't have their address here or their phone number, but maybe somebody will call in and give it to you. But I'm just amazed that Americans don't even know where to find a copy of their Constitution. Library is the first thing that comes into anybody's, or should come into anybody's mind. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello?
Bill. Bill from Illinois.
Yeah?
Yeah. Bill, I was up at a Joe McCarthy Memorial this last spring up in Wisconsin.
Uh-huh.
And Eustace Mullins gave a speech at this group that annually honors Joe McCarthy. I talked to him for a few minutes. And
Are you on a cell phone or something?
Yeah, I am.
Get off and call me back on a regular phone.
Okay.
It's really bad connection. Really bad.
Okay, I'll call back.
All right. 520-333-4543 is the number. I wish I could have kept him on, but you weren't going to hear what he had to say. Good evening. You're on the air.
Mr. Cooper, Carmine from Pennsylvania.
Hi, Carmine.
The World Almanac has the complete Constitution in it and the Declaration of Independence and the Bill of Rights and all that.
Which World Almanac?
The one that's used by the Daily News, the one you buy for like $6 at the stationery store.
There's lots of different World Almanacs, all printed by different publishers. We need to know the one, because I've got two here that don't have it in it, and I've
okay,
got another
one. It's called the World Almanac. Give me 1 second, I have it right here.
Okay. Hurry up. He's going to get the publisher. All we need is the name of the publisher, so that when they pick up the World Almanac, they can make sure it's the right one. Otherwise, they'll get one that's published by somebody who maybe doesn't have it in there. Because the World Almanac, by definition, is not concerned with politics in individual countries except as statistics. Are you back? Hello?
I have to get back to you.
All right. And when you call in, folks, to give us information, make sure you have all the information. Okay? 520-333-4543 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Turn down my radio. Joe from Boston, how you doing?
All right.
I'm going to send you the donation this month. I heard something on the radio which upset me, and you may be interested. I think it was Billy Dean. It was the other night about prepaid legal. I don't know if you heard it. Some people are having some problems with them, and they're not happy with them. So I just wanted to mention that they didn't get into it.
Do you have the specifics?
Only part of it. They talked about stocks and then it faded out. And
talked about what?
Something about stocks and how these attorneys are buying stocks in the company and HMOs, and it faded right out. They started to talk about it.
Don't spread rumor.
No, I'm just telling you what they said on the radio.
You haven't told us anything. What you did is come in and you've said you've maligned a company that I happen to know is a very good company, and you won't even can't even give us specifics on what you're talking about.
I will try and find out more.
Next time, find out before you call.
Yes, okay.
Okay.
I wanted to mention something else about this, the sheeple, which you mentioned. I spoke to someone about Congressman Condon. Is that his name? Am I saying it right? Condon?
We don't, we're not interested in that stuff on this podcast.
Okay, I just wanted to say about the people that...
We're not even interested on this broadcast about Congressman Condon, who is innocent until he's proven guilty.
I agree with you. But the thing that upset me is people say, it's okay to search your home without a warrant. What do you have to hide? I said, that's not the point, sir. I said, we have rights. People are giving away their rights. I just wanted to point that out.
That's because they're stupid.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Nine times out of ten, they don't even know they have those rights.
That's right. Okay, thank you.
You hear people all the time banging them. Well, I got my Fifth Amendment right. Yes, and what they are, they can't tell you.
Yeah, I know.
Thanks for calling.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Folks, don't ever call this broadcast to give us information unless you have the information. And I mean all of it. Don't call and recommend a book if you can't tell us who wrote it and who the publisher is and the name of the book. Don't call and cite something that you read in a newspaper article unless you can tell us the newspaper, the date it was printed, and the page in that newspaper. Don't call and start maligning somebody, either a person or an organization or a church or anything, unless you've got your facts straight and can state them. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, Bill. It's Bill from Illinois calling back again. I was up at the Joe McCarthy Memorial this last April, and Eustace Mullins was a keynote speaker there, and I got a chance to talk and ask him if he knew you. He said that you guys used to hang out together for a while there.
Hang out together?
Yeah.
That's not true at all.
That's not true?
No, he just flat-ass lied to you. We were both invited to London to speak at Wembley Hall years ago. And we stayed in the same hotel. And in fact, I read him the Riot Act because of his racism that came out when we were all sitting around a table there talking. And he just was insulting to a lot of people.
Have you read his book, Curse of Canaan?
Yeah.
What did you think of that?
I think it's bullshit. Total bullshit.
Well, that's about it. I just want to check up on that because I heard something else, though.
Now, well, it's just not true. No, I've never hung out with him. I've never been his friend. I met him in London. Never talks to him very much. I was at a large table where there's a whole bunch of people sitting when he just absolutely insulted a lot of people at the table who were not of his race.
Really?
Yeah.
Well,
it was disgusting. I believe racism is a plague upon the human race.
Well,
it's a plague.
I don't believe it at all. I pretty much, my business, I work with everybody. And
there's two things in this world that cause most of the problems that everybody, well, three things, actually. Most of the problems that we ever have, whether they're on an individual local level, or a state level, or a national level, or an international level, and that's greed, religion, and racism. If we could eliminate those three things from our society, we'd pretty much have it made. Now, I'm not talking about religion as your own personal religious views. I'm talking about churches, big churches with lots of money that tell people what they're supposed to believe and make them act in certain ways that sometimes causes terrible things to happen in this world and in this country, in this state, everywhere. Okay?
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks for calling.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I think Eustace Mullins is full of crap. Good evening. You're on the air.
Comment again, and it's Prime Media, PRIMEDIA. They're out of Mahwah, New Jersey.
For what?
For the Almanac, the World Almanac.
Okay, Prime Media.
And I buy one every other year, and they've always had the Constitution in it.
Okay.
You ready?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
520-333-4543. Good evening. You're on the air.
How you doing, Bill?
Good.
This is Mac from New Jersey.
Hi, Mac.
And I always carry a constitution in my pocket. I'm a little nervous.
No, take a deep breath and relax.
Okay, I have a question. I have made out a little note that I keep sending my congressmen and my senators, and I never get answers from them.
And you're still sending the note?
Yes, and
why?
What I want to know...
Now, wait a minute. Let's back up now.
Okay.
You've been sending it... How many times have you sent it?
I sent 4 times to Saxton.
Okay.
I sent it to Bradley when he was in.
Uh-huh.
Lautenberger.
Uh-huh.
All these people previously...
Now, wait a minute. I asked you a question to get an answer. I got my answer, and I'm going to ask you another question.
Okay.
Why are you still sending the note?
Because I want to know whether the Constitution is still in effect or it isn't.
But they've already told you something already. They don't care about you or your question, and they're not going to answer it.
Thank you.
That's your answer.
I know that.
Okay.
But what I'd love to do is get a signature that would tell me that.
They're not going to give you a signature that will tell you
that. Okay, so I'm on my own.
Because the minute they do that, they know you have a right to take up arms against them.
And that's exactly why I want them to... I was figuring maybe I could send it, you know...
The Supreme Court has already said the Constitution's not in effect. It says, wherever treaties conflict with the Constitution for the United States of America, the treaty shall take precedence. Whenever there's a conflict between the United Nations and the Constitution for the United States of America, the United Nations Charter will take precedence. And any judge considering such cases shall have copies of both in front of him. It's a Supreme Court ruling. I keep trying to tell people that when we joined the United Nations and passed the UN Participation Act in 19, you know, way back then, right after the war, we joined a world government in formation. And the United States of America has been the responsible party that created that world government, gave them the land to put their buildings on, sent people to write the United Nations Charter, have funded them over all of these years. And it is the avowed and stated policy of the United States government to create a world government, disarm all peoples and all nations, create a world police force, and all of that is treason, and it's all out in the open. Nothing is hidden. It's all available to anybody who wants to look for it.
I'm well informed on that.
Then why?
I read your book 3 times, and I started years ago with Philip Wiley's Generation of Vipers, and I've been on this since then. But you've answered my question. I know I'm on my own.
No, you're not. I'm with you.
I understand that. That I do understand.
There is nobody in Washington, D.C. who is not committing treason, and they all know that they're committing treason.
Right. I wrote Chuck Schumer on that, too, and I didn't get a damn letter. I called them a traitor.
Yep, they are.
And I never get an answer from that, either.
They are.
I did write Whitman when she got in down here in New Jersey. I'm a little crazy, so I told her to secede and all this. But I never got an answer, but I did get a phone call. Having said that, though, you answered my question, and thank you very much.
Thanks for calling.
Adios.
520-333-4543 is the number. Taking your calls for the whole hour. It's open topic, open season, open subject, open mouth, insert foot. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello?
Turn your radio off. Goodbye. Can't handle that, folks. You ought to know by now, whether you ever call this program or not, just from listening to other programs, that when you call a radio show, you have to turn your radio off. Not down, but off. She just about blew my eardrums out. You have no idea how much that hurts. 520-333-4543. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, Bill. Hi there. The former governor of Massachusetts, Paul Salucci, is now the U.S. ambassador to Canada, and I have him quoted in Canadian National Post saying that there could be a NAFTA plus relationship. They're calling for harmonization of border controls, law enforcement, energy, environmental, and immigration policies.
You know,
of achieving a more fully integrated economy.
You know what that really means, don't you?
It's region one. Here it comes.
It means eventually do away with the border altogether.
Uh-huh.
And have no restrictions between the two countries, and we would actually be melded, just as you said, in region one of the New World Order. The only other one that would have to be, and this is what NAFTA and GATT's all about, the other one that has not been brought in yet is Mexico. Region one of the New World Order is the United States, Canada, and Mexico.
He says, we have to talk about being more consistent in policies. We don't want Canadian citizens or U.S. citizens to be spending 3 or 4 hours trying to cross the border. No one wants to go down that road. We need to use technology and some more consistent policies to make it more convenient.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, you know, you talked about that over 10 years ago,
mm-hmm.
but that... Here we have it in.
Yeah,
you know,
I told everybody.
The impetus is there, and we know it.
Yeah, I told everybody that it would absolutely happen. Do you know when GATT was first signed?
Yes.
When?
78?
Nope. In the 1920s.
Well, I didn't know.
1978 was just an update, a revamping of GATT. That's why it's always been easier to go across the Canadian border and easier to stay longer than it is to go across the Mexican border.
Right.
And stay.
Uh-huh.
GATT's been enforced since the 1920s.
Fascinating.
Yeah, isn't it?
I loved your response earlier to the caller about his email being quarantined.
Yeah.
That was hilarious.
Well, it ought to be hilarious. I couldn't even believe that I heard it.
No, me neither. It was funny. Thanks, and good night to you.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling. 520-333-4543. Don't forget, folks, when you call, turn your radio off, please. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah. Bill?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I just purchased a real interesting book. It's John Quincy Adams, Letters on Freemasonry.
Uh-huh.
And I'm really amazed at some of these forefathers' ability to express their the king's language. I mean, it's absolutely amazing.
Nobody understands the language today, and one of the reasons is so that you won't understand the law.
These guys are, I mean, this John Quincy Adams, he's brilliant. He's an amazing writer. And if you're interested, I can give out the publishing company of this.
Go ahead. Everybody should read it.
Okay. I don't want to plug anybody. I can tell who I got it through. Is that all right?
No, just give the name of the book, the author, and the publisher.
All right.
And they can get the book from their own sources.
Okay. John Quincy Adams, Letters on Freemasonry. And it's Rivercrest, that's all one word, Publishing, 1708 Patterson Road.
All they need is the name of the publisher.
Okay.
Who's the author? Oh, John Quincy, I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, well, it was his...
I've got the book, and I'm asking you who the author is.
Yeah, well, okay, well...
Go ahead.
it was by John Quincy Adams. According to the guy who's putting out the book, who's reprinting it, it hasn't been available to the public since, like 1847. Right here it says, Letters on Freemasonry was originally published in 1833 as Letters on the Masonic Institution. This uncut, unabridged, and unrevised edition was published under its current title in 1847 by T.R. Marvin Press in Boston.
Yeah.
And it talks about John Quincy Adams and respective letters to other members of this state back in the Union then.
Who was John Quincy Adams?
Pardon?
Who was John Quincy Adams?
John Quincy Adams was the son of John Adams.
Very good. What else is
the president?
There you go.
And I'm about a half of a sheep, and I'm really starting to.
That's okay. You know, I could never have learned what I've learned, and I could never be doing what I do now unless at some point I realized that I had been ignorant all my life, that I'd been relying on other people to tell me the truth, and they hadn't been doing it,
mm-hmm.
and that I was a sheeple,
mm-hmm.
and that I was stupid, and I had to change that.
Uh-huh.
And before I did those things, I could never have made any changes or learned what I've learned and be able to pass that on to my listening audience
well,
and
yeah,
many
I mean,
other people.
Common sense. I mean, if a person is a stupid
person,
to get themselves an education.
You'd be amazed at how people resist that.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
We're out of time.
Okay.
Thanks for calling.
Thanks a lot for your encouragement.
You're welcome.
All right.
Well, folks... Oh, my goodness. We're out of time. And so, good night. God bless each and every single one of you. Good night, Annie Quinn Allison. I love you. Been listening to the Hour of the Time. You're truly William Cooper, the most dangerous radio host in America, according to William Jefferson Clinton. Don't miss tomorrow night's broadcast. You're going to learn the business relationship of the Bin Laden family, like in Osama Bin Laden, with George Herbert Walker Bush and his son, George W. Bush, who is now the President of the United States of America. Whoa, that's heavy, huh? Don't miss tomorrow night's broadcast.